come with us now, if you dare, down a rickety staircase into a dank, dark basement. What awaits? The Saturday Night Freak Show.
Hey, thanks for listening to the Saturday Night Freak Show podcast.
Oh, thank you so much.
I found out tonight we don't like your kids.
Yeah, we don't like your kids.
No, I'm sorry.
Stop posting about them on Facebook. Like,
that was our pre-recording discussion.
I went on a rant about not giving shit about anyone's kids.
Yeah.
That's why I went off Facebook, and I'm sorry. Whatever.
But that's okay. You can find us on Facebook. We're
Facebook.com/Saturday Night Freak Show.
We're also on Twitter. We don't know if Holly is, but we're on Twitter.
I have a Twitter, but I don't use it.
Freak Show. Twitter's where it's at, Holly.
It's all political. Except the stuff that you post.
It's gotta be like,
I just post funny
shit. Who you follow. Like the Saturday Night Freak Show. Where, Sean?
At Sat Freak Show.
We also have an email.
SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com. I do have an email.
Yep.
Yeah. And I use it.
That's what she's just going back to.
She's
email,
like, if you want to talk to me, just email me.
Email me.
Well, that's what I do at work. Everything at work, email me. Don't call me. Don't.
No.
What's your extension? No. Don't call me.
No.
Email me.
Are you on Instagram?
I am on Instagram. I use my Instagram all the time, actually.
You probably subscribe to Saturday Night Freak Show on Instagram.
I do.
There we go.
Yay.
Do I?
I fucking hope so, Sean.
Pretty sure I do.
Where else would you have seen Holly's cartoon of us?
I tagged him. Yeah. I tagged all of you.
She sent it to me. She's a friend of mine.
Yeah,
she
we're friends.
Just send me shit. So
we're friends.
That does happen. Yeah.
Sweet. Well,
folks, I've never met Holly.
Well, we haven't actually.
We're actually all on Skype right now.
Right.
In case you couldn't tell, we're not in the same room. We're all on
behind
Skype.
The curtain, folks. We've all recorded all our audio separately for years.
For years,
we've never been together.
Yep.
And Colin just edits it all together seamlessly.
Tiny little monitor. Yep.
Then my cartoon would have been even more impressive.
You just put guessed Skype logo in the bottom of it. Yeah. Who are these people who are talking
to? Who are we?
Yeah.
Who are we?
We're still figuring that out.
Yeah.
I'm Holly, internet radio superstars. I'm Holly.
Sean.
Michaela.
And I'm Colin. And we also want to thank you if you have already liked, subscribed, given us a rating, given us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn. So thank you very much. We appreciate it. If you haven't.
Thank you.
There's always a first time. Get on over there.
Feel free to write more letters specifically to me. I've gotten like three already. So I'm all
letters
for that.
To you.
Specific?
Well, like there was that guy on Instagram that wrote specifically to me on your account.
Remember,
this week.
That seems confusing.
Yeah, on my account, he put a message for Michaela. Thanks for that.
He said he was an Amazon.
Yeah, tell Michaela that she has a fan who drives like a delivery truck
for Amazon in Reno, Nevada. And I was like, awesome.
Oh,
so great. Wow. I was like, yeah, I love Michaela too.
Thanks for writing in.
Thanks for joining that ever-growing freak show family.
Wonderful. Yeah.
So tonight we watched a movie that was chosen by...
Michaela.
Jesus Christ. This is not hard to do. She's sitting right in the hot seat.
She's in the captain's chair.
But Colin, we're on Skype, so he doesn't know that.
That's why I was so confused.
Sean's supposed to look at his calendar from his Skype desk and check it off appropriately, and he didn't do that.
Actually, I'm not at my Skype desk. I'm in the kitchen making a sandwich. Sorry.
That's what all the clanking is, huh?
Yes. Chosen by Michaela. Michaela, what do we watch?
Michaela and I talked like through the entire movie, so it's
and a lot of our lists, Holly, are interchangeable.
This is true. We pick a lot of similar movies.
Tonight's movie was Fear from 1996.
Okay. I was trying to figure out how old I was when I saw this movie.
I was in sixth grade.
I was 10.
Yeah,
I don't know what that means.
You
want to
know how old I was when
this
movie came out?
Wow. Well, it changes the way that you see the movie.
No, I don't. I'm curious as all hell.
I was 6 years old when
this
movie
came out. There you go. How old were you when you first saw it?
Oh, like 15.
Oh, okay. All right.
Why did you first
age
see
appropriate?
It?
Wait, what is this rated? It's got to be R.
PG-13, I guess.
No.
There was only one fuck, wasn't there?
I mean, there was a lot of fucking.
I think there was a couple,
but there was only one actual fuck word.
Where's the rating?
I thought there was a couple.
R, it is R.
It is R. I kind of figured that. It feels like an R rating.
Yeah, it's.
They could have pushed it more for an R though. It felt like it kind of rides that line.
There's some extreme. I thought it was some extreme stuff that probably wouldn't squeak by in PG. Maybe now. No, I don't know. It's just the material, the tone, the intensity, and the
Scream was the same year, right?
Scream is R.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. That's I feel like that's a harder R than this movie.
Oh, well, definitely. Yeah. Where's the boundary of the R rating? Yeah, is the
this
question.
Is on the lower scale of the R.
Because we were discussing this, or we talked about this, like, I think earlier in the week, because you were watching movies, and we have been watching movies that are, like, rated PG. I'm just like, that's got boobs in it.
It's got boobs. There's ass and boobs PG. In this movie.
From the good old days, like, the heyday of the PG.
The ratings didn't mean so much back in the day.
I was watching
that. Got a handle of them.
Yeah. I was watching Sheena. I think that was the one from 1984.
Wait, rated PG. Sheena, Queen of the Jungle?
Yeah.
With oh, my God.
Have you been reading my mind, Colin?
No, what happened?
She literally messaged me like 2 days ago. I was like, I think I should pick this. Like 2 days ago.
Because I saw the
Colin
poster.
Was watching it and giving a commentary.
I saw the poster of her riding the zebra, and I was like, I need to pick this movie.
Yeah.
It's and then I watched the trailer and was like, oh my God, I have to pick this movie.
Well, there we go.
Okay, so well, maybe I shouldn't say anymore.
But we all share a brain, apparently.
Because I was live tweeting it. Maybe now, I don't know. Are you following me on Twitter?
I don't have a Twitter account. Oh, okay. I'm not on Twitter.
No, it's only me, Colin. Yeah. I'm the only one.
But for a PG rated movie, I was surprised.
Well, now I have to watch. We have to pick this at some point now. Yeah.
Well, wait a month from now.
There you go.
Sheena. All right. Like I said, she's riding a zebra on the poster. I was like, I'm sold. Yeah.
Wait until she talks. No, okay, I can't even tell you.
No, don't say that. No, that'll be. It feels like it'll be gold.
Yeah, we'll get into that.
Yeah. Yes. So this movie, just for housekeeping, who's the director on this film?
All right, James guys, Foley? We're going to go on a little bit of a journey with the director here.
Okay.
So James Foley is the director.
Wait, don't tell me. Did he do Copland?
I think so, but that's not what I have in my notes.
Okay, sorry, go ahead.
In my notes, I have, okay, before this, he did a very well-known, held in high regard movie called Glengarry Glen Ross.
So
he did this 4 years before Fear.
Yeah.
Is that the Always Be Closing?
Yeah.
Fuck, man.
And then, fast forward to present day.
Oh, get out.
But the man has directed 50 Shades Darker and 50 Shades Freed.
There it is.
Oh, really?
Yes.
There it is.
Wow.
What a fucking spectrum to be on.
Yeah.
Glengarry Glen Ross in 1992. Fast forward to 2018, 50 Shades Freed.
Was Glengarry, that was his first one?
I believe his first full length that I saw. There was a lot of shorts and a lot of TV.
He did also Madonna.
A lot of Madonna music videos. He did Perfect Stranger with Halle Berry and Bruce Willis in 2007.
After Dark, My Sweet.
Oh, that was before. Before or after Glengarry? Because I remember that one. Yeah, okay, that was the one.
He did Deep Purple, King of Dreams. Mm-hmm. Bravo, sir.
Sean's a big Deep Purple
fan. Purple fan.
He did
an episode of Twin Peaks.
He was the principal director for House of Cards, too. Did a lot of House of Cards episodes. Okay.
You know what, though? Now that you say that, I really can put Fear next to 50 Shades Darker and 50 Shades Freed, I fucking see that. Yeah. I can see it for sure.
He's found his pocket, man.
Yeah.
Well, who's the writer? The screenwriter was like Christopher Crowe.
And this is the last movie he ever wrote.
What was the first movie he ever wrote?
Last of the Mohicans, I believe.
Get the fuck.
Oh,
really?
Wow. Wow.
That was like 95?
He writes a lot of TV. He writes a lot of TV in between here and there. 92. But
that is
he stopped writing altogether in like 99.
Okay.
So
did he die?
I didn't look into that, but his IMDb was very short, so it's entirely possible. But this was the last movie he ever wrote. So
Last of the Mohicans and Fear.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. What a spectrum, huh?
Well, you're on a roll, you know, in Hollywood, and you just go like, where's the money at? And has this idea.
And as we talked about while we were watching the movie, the score was done by Carter Burwell, who is best known for doing basically every Coen Brothers movie ever. Three Billboards most recently.
Yep. And which I loved. I loved that score. I loved that score.
See, like, Carter Burwell, I have a very hot and cold relationship with. Mm-hmm. A lot of his movies, I don't particularly care for the score, especially like True Grit. I did not like the score for that movie at all. But he also did three of the five Twilight movies.
There it is. There it is. So,
varied career.
His career is especially varied. Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. I didn't hate the music in Twilight. I didn't hate it.
Score. Not a soundtrack.
Yeah, score.
Score.
Let's be real about it.
Like the soundtrack album to the first Twilight.
Yeah, I don't hate it. Yeah.
Soundtrack or score? Because he did the score.
Well, I mean, I remember the score because Bella's theme, I remember. Yeah. But the score, there was one song in that soundtrack that I actually went and got the album. Blue October? That's pretty good.
But that's different.
Blue
that's
October.
Soundtrack is horror, too.
Well, that was a soundtrack.
Entirely different things. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Carter Burwell did the score.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember.
Except for Bella's theme. That was written by Robert Pattinson.
Oh, that was on the soundtrack album.
That was written by Robert Pattinson.
Yeah, he's actually a musician.
Mm-hmm. I'll be damned.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Aren't they all? Fuck them.
Oh, they're all triple threats, man. I mean.
I also make music.
They gotta be triple threats.
I'm just saying, it wasn't bad.
I'm trying to figure out where Twilight is going to be like 20, you know, after people go through the like, it's awesome, then the I hate it, and then eventually
like
the nostalgia, you know, thing where you go
it's
back.
It's
going
to be the Wraith of its time.
It's going to be like a time capsule.
It's going to be a time capsule.
Like, look at this fucking movie that my mom liked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not going to be good, but it'll be a time capsule. Exactly.
The clothes, vampires, the music, it's a time capsule. It's a time capsule. Absolutely.
That's the shit kids are going to find in the attic is Twilight books.
Yeah.
And like,
they're
going to
open up a trunk and be like, what the fuck is this? That's what they're going to find. How depressing is that?
I mean, I don't know.
I mean,
probably thought the same thing about the stuff.
I found some depressing shit. My mom, I found thousands of romance novels that my mom had collected over the years.
I was gonna say, like, what, I mean, it's,
the ones with Fabio on the front, sexually holding a woman.
I was gonna say, like, when we were kids, we found Danielle Steele. Our kids are gonna find
DC Andrews.
Well, they're gonna find 50 Shades.
Yeah, oof. Exactly.
Yeah.
That's unfortunate.
It is. It really
is. I'm just like smacking. I was like, put that down.
It's mostly unfortunate because it started as fan fiction, whereas like our parents' generation, they were actual writers. That's the most disappointing part of that, I think.
Yeah.
That's Don't worry. True. Your son's just going to go through all your horror movies, probably, like you did.
Hopefully. That's what I'm going to be like. Yeah,
you're like, oh, no, no.
Put
he
Fabio
probably shouldn't
down.
Watch
Let's
that
watch
one.
Fright Night. This will be better.
Yeah. So Fear brings us a Star is Born. In this film, is this true? I'm not entirely sure. The career trajectory of the one,
Marky
the
Mark?
Only Marky Mark of the Funky Bunch.
I think this launched Reese Witherspoon, but not
Marky
Mark.
Yeah, okay.
Not Marky
Mark. He was in Basketball Diaries before this. Right. If you have not seen it, it is a great movie. It's a hard to watch movie.
Very hard to watch.
But it is a good movie. Him and DiCaprio are both fucking great in that movie.
Yeah.
Holy shit, it is a hard to watch movie.
It is a hard to watch.
It's a Criterion movie.
Yeah, it's good, man. It's overlooked for sure too. But yeah, before this he was Mr. Calvin Klein.
Yeah.
And Funky Bunch, Mr. Funky Bunch as well. And he was trying to shed that image with this movie.
Good vibration.
Hells yeah.
Yeah. That's a jam, man.
I just remember that what was it? The movie Rockstar. I think in the bloopers there's a bloopers reel on it where they're doing one of the scenes where he's what is it? Steel Dragon?
Yeah, Steel Dragon.
Steel Dragon.
Mm-hmm.
Where they're doing the onstage stuff and they just start playing Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch, just in the background, just to fuck with him. Yeah. That's pretty funny.
Yeah. Well, Reese Witherspoon had done, wasn't she like in, no, she
the,
wasn't
she was in
Man
in the Moon.
Man in the Moon, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And there was like
Freeway?
SFW
was Freeway
before
or Highway?
It was
Freeway.
Freeway.
Shit. That was after?
That was after this, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm. I still
I love
haven't
that
seen that movie.
Oh, I love that movie.
I know, but there's like three of them?
Freeway movies?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know. If
somebody was just talking about
one?
Them recently. And, yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. There's more than one Freeway.
Oh, shit. She wasn't in all of them, was she?
No, I don't think anybody. I don't even think Kiefer is.
I like the first Freeway. That's a good movie.
Yeah. Okay, so she was basically, this was her first, like, grown-up adult?
Yeah, because she was, like, a fucking
teen. This
adult.
Is her teen. Yeah, I know, because, like, she looks like she's 12.
But she looked even younger in The Man in the Moon. She
did.
Like a child.
I remember,
that
movie.
Yeah.
The movie's uncomfortable.
I don't ever need to rewatch it.
It's an uncomfortable movie.
Yeah.
So this movie puts Reese Witherspoon,
stop calling her little.
Yeah, she was 19.
Reese Witherspoon.
She was 19. I looked it up.
Is
while
she
we were
playing 16? Is that?
Yeah, she's 19 right. playing 16.
She's a tiny person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So she's got that young face. You know?
But at the same time, she hasn't really aged that much.
She looks great.
She looks basically the same. Yeah.
I haven't even seen what she. Well, she was on the HBO show.
Yeah, I watched that. Yeah.
She does not look aged compared to that.
Yeah,
no, she's done pretty good.
Good genes.
Mm-hmm. Very good genes.
It's a lot of play younger
and money.
Characters.
And money.
And
that's
money.
That's a good point. That's a very good point.
Very true. All right, one of my favorite characters, Tracy Flick.
Criterion Collection.
I got that. That's very good.
Mm-hmm. Well, Fear is kind of like, I mean, how do we describe this? It's
teen
kind of
Fatal Attraction.
Yes, there you go.
Yes.
Okay, so it's Fatal Attraction, primarily aimed at a female audience, where you take the leads,
it's
flip the genders, and reduce the age by at least 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when was The Crush?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That was 94.
That's Alicia Silverstone and Carrie
Elwes.
So 2 years before this?
It's Fatal Attraction again, except it's a much younger woman.
I mean, the 90s were full of this kind of movie, though, right? You know?
That's what I'm going after. Yeah. It's like, was that going on in the 90s?
Oh, so the 90s were a time where, like, psychological thrillers were, like, sexy. You know? Like,
oh, yeah. Psychological thrillers. God, I would have stopped at that section of the video.
Well, I was just talking to a friend of mine. Like, you remember in the 90s, like, psychiatrists were the heroes of, like, every other movie.
What is that Bruce Willis movie?
The Sixth Sense?
Yes. Color of Night. That's exactly what I was fucking thinking of. I was like, that was like the height of like psychology is sexy movies is Color of Night.
Yeah.
Because there's like full-on penetration in that movie.
Full-on penetration?
Yes.
Shit.
Jesus. Like in a pool.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Goddamn.
I remember there was a director's cut. Yeah, yep. But I mean, there was
he said finally into the microphone.
Well, I don't remember the full penetration. I remember the deal was see his dick in that.
Yep.
And like, I don't remember seeing it. So.
But much more, but you see his dick in more of a way than you see it in like Ben Affleck Gone Girl sense. Because like, they touted that for Gone Girl. Oh, and it was like a quick cut of like almost nothing.
They hyped that up. You barely saw anything.
Yeah. Bat dick.
Mm-hmm. We'll call it. But yeah, the 90s were like psychological thrillers were so sexy. Right. It was like the 90s, yeah.
But it was odd because Fatal Attraction was 87, so this is about 10 years later.
Almost,
Redressed Fatal Attraction. Well, that's not entirely true. That is kind of my memory of this movie as I went into it. Turned out it wasn't entirely
I mean, but it's the best way to describe it.
Yeah, you know? I guess for the concept of it. You got an innocent little girl who meets a guy from the other side of the track. Well, no, he doesn't even come off that way.
You just make it sound creepy in your description.
Well, because it is, isn't it?
I mean, it's a creepy movie,
dude.
I mean,
well, yes, it is. As it should be, I guess.
He kind of is from the other side of the tracks, though, because she skips school, and that's when she meets him.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, you know he's not in school at the very most.
Well, I think he's not in school because he looks like he's 28.
Yeah. But, like, I mean, that's how she meets him is by, like, doing something bad off
schoolers built like that.
Exactly.
Playing pool and drinking beer at like 2 p.m.
Yeah.
On a weekday.
On a weekday. On a school night.
Playing pool was the key factor of like, oh, he's a bad boy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
He's playing pool.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it was the 90s.
Thermal he was wearing while he was doing it.
Tucked into his fucking jeans.
That's how we told people that we were serious was by playing pool.
Colin
was there.
Colin was there.
I was at the fucking pool hall all the time. That's why when you were seeing that, this is okay. Yeah. Admitting something probably dark and horrible about myself.
Let's do it. That's why we're here, Colin.
Well,
Skype therapy session.
When Alyssa Milano went up to the guy in the leather jacket and the long hair, and I can't remember. That's what I was patterning my look after. The sweaty leather jacket, bearded, long hair, pool hall guy. Yeah.
Just to put an image out there for all you people who have not seen this movie or are not aware of what we're talking about. If you've ever seen It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, you know that this movie has a lot of connections to that TV show. One of those connections is that this character looks exactly like Rickety Cricket. Like, he is dirty. He's got the meth face going on.
Like a tough cricket, because cricket's
is he, though? Like, I mean, I don't... Tough is generous, I think.
Colin, I believe you lived in a leather jacket for months on end. Slept in it, woke up in it, did acid in it.
I would not be scared. He wants to be tough.
I would not be scared of Cricket. I would be scared of this guy. He's a fucking date rapist.
Yeah, he's a scumbag.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's dirty and just the hair and the face.
Yeah, he's got that meth face going on and it's not good.
It's horrible. And then... For some reason, this, like, hot Alyssa fucking Milano at, like, 18 years old, fucking hot, walks in and she's like, ooh la la. I'm like, are you kidding me?
He looks 40.
Are you kidding me?
He's dirty and trashy and I want it.
40 compared to her, though. Like, he looks so much older.
Oh, my God.
He's done a lot of drugs.
Yeah. I mean, Marky Mark, I get it. I get it.
Especially at this point in time.
Yes. I get it. But that guy? Yeah. I don't get it.
Especially because we should mention this is, I mean, you know, this is right after Calvin Klein. So, like, peak physical condition.
Oh, God, those fucking briefs, man. You know?
But, everyone else in this movie, what? Like, all of his lackeys are, like, disgusting. Meth heads. Like, disgusting. Terrible looking, you know?
Just grimy dudes.
Well, you've all seen this movie, right? You know we're talking about
this. You've seen this movie. Have
I had never seen
Sean, I can't believe you had never seen this. One.
Wait, are you kidding me? Sean, you gotta think back to the time when every movie we mentioned, Sean was like, I've never seen that. The Godfather, Sean? No.
But
Empire Strikes
all right,
Back?
Get it out,
no?
Colin. Okay. What else are we gonna
make? No, I know what you're saying, but I also think like this came out, like when this came out, like hormonal Sean, I feel like, should have watched this.
I mean, you're right.
You know what
like,
I mean?
This would have been right up my alley.
Yeah.
That's hormonal Sean.
Exactly.
For how much you love Scream and for the fact that this came out the same year, I can't believe you missed this movie. Like, that shocks me.
Yeah. If it wasn't playing around USA or HBO at the time, then I guess I just
this
didn't
see
it.
This is on cable a lot, actually.
This
You'd be surprised how often this movie is on
cable. I missed it somehow.
Yeah, this was a big part of my adolescence.
I feel like it would have been a big part of mine.
Yeah? Well, see, I mean, maybe I was not... Well, I don't know. I mean, I was closer in age at the time to probably
Marky Mark.
Yeah. Which is like, I think at the beginning half of the movie, I think that's where my identification was, actually, like more with him. Not the, overly violent, you know,
With
aggressive.
The pursuant of the young woman?
Oh, but yeah, God. I guess in that, you know, like that dynamic, it's like this is a girl falling in love with this guy, you know, who's like trying to, you know, seduce her basically, or he's, you know, becoming Mr. Right, moving into her perfect family life. And then, you know, obviously the movie, it's a horror movie. What is it, a horror movie? It's a home invasion
movie. It's a thriller.
It's a thriller. It's not horror.
But like,
no.
But like,
there is a moment that is just,
there
that
are
got
horror
me.
Moments.
Like,
yeah,
whoa.
I know. Awful. Like to a young girl watching this, I thought it was scary as shit.
He was borderline triggering for me at some point.
Me too.
That
last
me
20
too.
Minutes, it was just like, whoa.
Yeah. It was really scary.
Marky Mark was 25 when they made this movie.
Oh, okay.
25?
Yeah.
And Reese Witherspoon was what,
19? Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which, I mean,
yeah.
I don't know.
I will say, like I don't see that much of an age difference between them when they're on screen together. Like, they, I think they play it pretty well between the two of them.
That's pretty good. He's young. He's young in the face.
Well, and we should.
Not the body.
We were talking about it through the whole movie, but his accent is out of fucking control.
Oh, man. Oh, it's fantastic.
It is.
It's
who can do the best Marky Mark impression?
So many bad guys out there. So many bad guys out there.
But there's like a music to it.
That there is.
Like you're doing the Boston, but
right. But to get
hey
his,
you guys,
His flow.
Hey you guys, are we going to the mall today? I mean, it's so.
Oh my god.
Is he a puppy dog?
Is he a dog?
But does he always talk like that?
Is he the dog from Up?
Yes, I know. Seriously.
Hi there.
Oh my god.
I mean, he does whisper a lot of his lines.
I don't think any of us can do it, but there is a musicality to it.
Colin just tried to do Fear and he did Homeward Bound instead.
Yeah. Well, I was trying to remember a line from, because it was the fucking Happening was the one where it was like, I can't take this guy.
Yeah.
You got all these honeybees? I can't fucking do it.
Yeah. Oh, like he does upspeak a lot where like his sentences end on an up note.
It's
really hard to listen to.
And that's Valley. That's, yeah, that's the Valley speak.
Yeah. Anyone has seen
it's fascinating to listen to as much as it is.
If anyone has seen the Saturday Night Live skit where he's talking
to
a goat.
Say hi to your mother for me.
Yeah. Hi, goat. I like your beard, goat. I got a beard, too.
Yeah. Say hi to your mother.
You ever seen The Perfect Storm? I had a beard, too. Like, it's hilarious and it's spot on.
I think Holly does the best one.
Thank you.
Holly does the best one. I'm not even going to try it.
He also says whore instead of whore.
You're fucking whore.
You're fucking whore.
You lace curtain motherfucker.
That was like Departed Wahlberg.
Yeah, that's straight Departed Wahlberg.
Yeah. Well,
Maybe not.
Maybe fuck yourself. Her parents in this are played by some fantastic people, I thought. William Peterson and Amy Brennan.
Brenneman.
From Heat. What else has she been in?
Judging Amy?
Judging Amy, of course.
And she was the ghost mom in Casper. Thank you very much.
There you go. William Peterson was in
Manhunter,
which is a fantastic film.
Yep.
And then he became he was on CSI forever. He's in an awesome movie that you should check out called To Live and Die in L.A. also.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
He's really good. It was like Manhunter and that and To Live and Die in L.A. are like the two like fantastic William Peterson movies.
And Fear.
And Fear.
Fear.
Well, okay, so that was, I guess, like a thing, like, you know, watching it this time, there was the, Well, I mean, I know you guys are going to talk about the like the experience of, you know, watching it as a younger woman and now.
Yes, I will talk about that experience.
Right. Yeah.
At length, I as assume we go through will. This podcast of watching it as a younger woman and how I felt about it at that time. Please, let's get into
all right,
that.
Let's hear about this, Sean. Explore it here. How was
as
it?
A young woman, very much, and I had
coming
very,
into your own, I get it.
Confusing feelings.
Yeah.
I was learning about my body.
Well, this is like, it's a coming of age movie, right? I mean, it's all kind of wrapped in the package. I mean, that's got to be part of the appeal of this is that you see, like, she starts off as a girl and emerges at the end as a woman. This is the idea that, you know, she has to go through, like, there's a moment where she confronts Alyssa Milano and she's like, you know, maybe I don't trust you. Maybe I can't trust anybody anymore. I can't remember what the line was,
really,
but that's like that kind of the, you know, the taking the blinds off what the adult world is like.
Right.
You know, that's
and
that moment.
If you look at that moment, look how she's dressed in that moment.
Well, she looks rough. So what they all do, it's like,
or just a little more mature at that point. Because look at what she wears in the rest of the movie compared to what she's wearing at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
It is. It's just, it's slacks. It's a tucked in like dress shirt in that point. Like she's dressed as more mature, more serious, I'll say, at that point when she's confronting those things.
That's a good point. I think the costume designer did a lot of heavy lifting in this movie.
I think so too. Absolutely.
Like, especially when you think about the first time we see her
and how
she's dressed.
That short dress with those socks.
Her dad literally says, didn't you wear that when you were 12 years old?
Yeah.
Like, her dad literally says that
to her. The socks. And the socks. Shoes.
The socks were a really good touch.
It was like a 1950s outfit.
I wore those socks when I was, like, five.
Yeah.
The ones that, like,
those ruffle.
With the ruffle socks. Yeah.
Yeah. You identify with, like, oh, you got your six-year-old little girl, and she wears shit like that. And then you see it on her, you're just like, whoa. Something
like, okay, jailbait, calm down.
Yeah. It's like, oh, add a few inches to that dress.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then I think, like, later on, it becomes, like, this is every parent's nightmare. I mean, I don't have kids, but, like, this time I'm identifying with the William Peterson character, and he is in a lot more of the movie than I remember, because it seemed to me the first time.
He's a big part of the movie. He's kind of the protagonist, right?
He kind of is, yeah.
But that's what surprised me.
This is his movie, right?
That's what surprised
me. It really is. It really is.
Because I was kind of, you know, I was thinking, how is this going to, well, I don't know, maybe I was going to talk about a little bit, of, you know, the climax, but
the roller coaster.
Which climax? There's a few.
The one you remember, that was funny. I was talking to a guy at work today and said, you know, it's like, yeah, we're watching Fear. And he's like, I think, is that a movie to have a roller coaster scene? I'm like, you would remember that. And he's like, I don't remember what happens. I'm like, what?
Yes, you do
remember
that
there's a roller coaster scene.
Yeah, you do.
Right? Oh, yeah, you remember that? No, not at all.
Yeah.
What? There's a roller coaster in that movie? Definitely don't remember that part.
That was the one with the stunt thighs or whatever. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I would assume.
Yeah. I don't know. She was 19. I was a minor.
I don't know how you shoot stuff like that. That's a weird one.
Well, I mean, we only saw below the waist and then cut to their faces and that was it.
We didn't see
anything in between. Yeah. There was no wide shots, so...
I was like, really? He just kind of held his hand there.
I mean, it's not true, really...
And like, the angle didn't make sense.
Yeah, he wasn't really doing much. Right.
It doesn't show, in the way they shoot it, you have close-ups on her face, his face, and then... legs, so it's quite possible that somebody else was in there just to be comfortable for
the only reason
possible,
that I thought
it was
is
possible.
Because the gyrations of the torso were different than
Well, I mean, I don't think he had a two camera setup on I'll say somebody else was in that position. Yeah.
Especially because when they cut to, like, Marky Mark's reactions, it looked like a different set or day entirely. You know, like, when they cut to him, like, while it's happening, like, it looks like a completely different time and place. I don't know. I didn't think it really lined up very well.
Yeah. It wouldn't surprise me if they used a stunt person for that, but it was pointless, but it wouldn't surprise me.
It wouldn't surprise me either, but at the same time,
maybe,
like...
Maybe not pointless to them. I don't know. The actors and stuff involved.
But, like, when you're a 19-year-old Reese Witherspoon, you only have The Man in Your Moon under your belt. Like, how much clout do you have to, like, pull that? I wonder.
I don't even know if a situation like that is clout. I think it's comfortableness for everybody. I don't know I don't know who you put in that situation who is comfortable. I can't.
Someone who's, like, 25 or
something. Sure, but someone who's older and more mature with that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a major possibility, especially when you're dealing with younger actors.
And maybe that's why I was thinking about it, because I thought she was younger than 19 when she made the movie. It was like, oh, okay, so you get somebody else to do this scene.
I think
maybe
all,
so. Maybe so.
Set to Wild Horses.
This movie will change your meaning of that song.
What's the name of it? When you said that, like, you're never going to hear Wild Horses again.
Yeah.
And I'm like, isn't that the song in The Silence of the
Lambs?
That's
Goodbye Horses.
Goodbye Horses. Goodbye Horses. Okay. Thank you very much. I'm like, what? They have that in the...
Yeah.
No, it's Goodbye.
Yeah.
Songs about horses,
and this is
man.
Like a, this is a cover. It's not it's the Rolling Stones original version. It's a cover of Wild Horses. So that, I mean, it's a slowed down... Just like, you know, it's weird that 20-some years later, now we're watching movies now where, like, the trend in the trailer is to do a slowed-down version of a very popular song in trailers.
Are they still doing that, or are we over that?
No, just, we're still doing
the,
it.
The Westworld trailer.
Yeah, there's we're a still doing box. It. Yep.
They did it with Tomb Raider. They did Survivor.
Yeah. It's still a trend, and it's like, wow, still 20 years ago, they actually did it in a scene,
do it with 50 Shades of Grey.
Yep.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
I haven't been paying attention. So yeah, the this was the buy-in moment when you saw this as young ladies, and you're like watching this movie and you're like, roller coaster scene I'm in.
I was just like, where's this gonna go from here?
It made me very uncomfortable.
Yeah, I was.
Yeah, you might have to be of a certain age.
Well, because you go into this. Okay, the movie's literally called Fear, so you know nothing good is going to happen.
Yeah,
and you've seen the trailer. Like, let me in your fucking house.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, you know nothing. Like, this isn't going to go to anywhere good. So
it's very scary.
That scared me that moment. Yeah. I was like, whoa! Again, in the last 20 minutes, I was like, wow.
Yeah, no, I want to say I think Marky Mark like really kind of pulls it off in this movie.
I think so too. Actually, he's creepy as fuck. Dude.
Yeah, made me uncomfortable.
He has that rage like
that's mostly his body.
Like, his rage is, like, just below the surface through most of the movie, but you can feel it's there.
It's the
It's tense,
it's the
man.
Yeah,
it's tense.
Like, oh, it's right there.
And then when it, like, boils over, it's, like, that much more unsettling because you knew it was coming for the whole movie. You know, it's...
Well, he plays, like, a... You know, he plays a guy who's been in and out of a bunch of...
Foster homes?
Foster homes and prison or jail
Mental
or something.
Mental institution.
Well, he says institution, but that could mean...
That could be a correctional institution.
I guess, but I guess if I'm hearing foster home and then institution, I'm thinking mental, not necessarily prison.
See, I automatically went to correctional institution.
Yeah, because he lists off, like, I thought he said Rikers.
He did
one
say
place.
Rikers when he's following this Gary place, in the woods. Place? Yeah. Then he says Rikers.
But he's, you know, with a group of guys who are, you know, clearly like, you know, criminals.
Yeah, it's a group of thugs.
And he's the most clean cut one of them, supposedly the leader. But he can ingratiate himself into her upscale family because he can actually, like,
He's very, very manipulative. Polite. He's very manipulative.
Right. Maybe that's what it is.
Yeah, he's very manipulative.
You know what
he can read people very well.
Very
too.
Well.
Yeah, I think that's So his psychology there is that's what makes him. You know what? One of the key telling things I thought was at the beginning where he goes out on a date with Reese Witherspoon. She says, "I got a curfew. I got to be home at midnight." And he's like, "Well," and he just sets the clock back.
Yeah,
I'm like, that's a good moment for that character because that means he is making his own reality. Only what matters to him.
Yeah,
like, that's the he is. That that's you're like you're not right in the head.
Well, but as to
and
viewers,
it can seem like it can go both ways. It can seem
I was going to say, as a viewer, it can seem very innocent, or it can seem very manipulative, depending on how you read it. But
maybe
it's a good setup
for
what's going to happen later on. Yeah. And, you know, the first time something like that happens, you're like, well, maybe it's, you know, something sweet and innocent. But then when that continues to be a pattern of behavior, that's when you're like, it's manipulative,
Because the movie isn't really
five minutes of cutscenes where he's just going to the house.
Changing all the clocks.
All the clocks are back. Because everything's a manual clock at this point.
Well, the movie, if it's going to be like a thriller, it doesn't really tip its hand early. I assume they were counting on the fact that, like, well, you'd seen the trailer and you knew what you were getting into, you know, when you bought the ticket. But there's nothing in that first, like, I don't know, 45 minutes of the movie that really says that he's really, like, this guy's dangerous, right? It's only when he starts to meet the family and there's that scene between him and William Peterson where basically it's like a pissing contest or the staring contest, or, you know, where it's like William Peterson gets the idea that, hey, there's something not right about this guy.
But that's what I love about it, because when you are in the trenches of a relationship like that, you're not going to see it right away. It's going to take a long time for you to get to that point.
Yeah.
And that is
Okay. If there's anything realistic about this movie, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Is the fact that he's not right off the bat fucking psycho, you know?
I remember watching, when I watched this as a kid, I was
right off the bat fucking psycho.
No.
You learn that later.
After you've invested.
That shit comes out later.
Yeah.
But I remember thinking that when I watched this as like a 12-year-old, I remember thinking, like, even then, I was like, wow, I really was like, oh, this guy's really sweet. And then I realized...
Because he speaks in a fucking hush whisper for the whole fucking movie.
A hush Boston whisper.
Yeah, and that was, it was so, like, eye-opening to me. I was like, oh my God, like, people are fucking nuts. Like, it's a scary world out there. This is actually very educational for young girls.
I think this is the appeal. Yeah. That's what I'm going to. This is the appeal of this movie. It's like, it does that very well.
Yeah,
but then it reaches a point where it starts being... horribly damaging in what it's telling you.
True.
Like, Alyssa Milano's character says some things that you're like, whoa, 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 whoa.
Oh, there's... Yeah.
That's not... at least, I don't know what the reaction was to that character in 1996.
Probably nothing.
Nothing. No. Now, it's like, whoa!
Yeah, it's very...
There is a point where Marky Mark shows up at school after him and Reese Witherspoon have been on a few dates.
He doesn't go to the school, by the way.
He does not go to the school. He is not a student at the school. So he just 25. Shows up.
Get, he's 32.
He just shows up and he sees her talking to her friend Gary.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
And he just jumps out of the car, beats the shit out of Gary, throws his hand back and knocks Reese Witherspoon out of the way, gives her a black eye. And later on, Alyssa Milano tells her, well, you know, sometimes that's their fucked up way of saying they love you.
That's a fucked up
And that
up
is
psychology.
The worst thing you could say in a movie.
Horrible, horrible.
Ever, maybe?
That's
like,
the worst thing you say in a movie or to say to a woman.
Just
at
to say
all.
In general, yeah. Ever. Yeah. It's, yeah. And it is brushed aside like a comment.
But we're not saying, I mean, like, those type of, that type of psychology also exists, that, you know, the person
oh,
is,
it does.
You know, like,
yeah.
Well, just explaining all this stuff away.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like that's a setup for Alyssa Milano's character,
yeah.
But at the same time, it's a really damaging thing to say.
But because she, like, apparently has no father in the home and her mom's absentee, like, the
mm-hmm.
entire time. She's
mm-hmm.
like
yeah.
a latchkey
yeah.
kid who, you know, yep. just kind of, and I don't know, like, if it's kind of setting something up, like, comparing her to the family dynamic of Reese Witherspoon, because it ends up that, like, you know, when she has her final breakdown, it's like, mm-hmm. you're my only friend, and she screws that
yeah.
relationship up.
Mm-hmm. I actually think, okay, now that you say that, it makes me think that, like, when Alyssa Milano's character said that, that was a setup for what happens to her character later on in the movie,
mm-hmm.
but even still in that moment, it is not a good thing to say. Like, I understand what it did for her character later on in the movie, but, like, just taking that one quote in the context of what and when it was said in the movie is still not a great thing.
Mm.
But for her character arc, I understand where that was telling us it was going,
mm-hmm.
given the third act of this movie.
Yeah, it has, I was surprised. Again, like mm-hmm. I said, watching this again, that, like, the writing is, like, pretty sharp on it. The, you were saying before that you thought that William Peter, like, it was William Peterson's movie?
Yeah, oh yeah, it totally is his movie. He's the hero. His intentions
okay.
are always good.
So, yeah.
Well, there's that.
But there's also the moment, like, there was a moment where I'm like, you know, recently I've been having this experience watching movies where you go, like, the guy who sounds crazy and says, like, we should just do this. And you're like, you know what? That person is the person who's got the right idea here,
yeah.
and no one's listening to
yep.
it.
No one's listening to him.
And
yeah.
he filled that role
yep.
in this one.
Yes.
He
yes,
was
he
like, no, we got to do something about this kid. He's crazy. Like, he's not
right.
crazy.
Everything will go against that until the bitter end, where you're just like,
mm-hmm.
until everyone else realizes they were wrong.
Right.
And shit's gone too far.
Because the thing I really appreciate about his character and this movie in general is, because I remember the first time I saw this, I was like, it's going to be a dad that's really overprotective of his daughter's virginity. That's going to be the storyline. But it's not that, actually. It's more, it's the virginity is not his issue as much as it is that, like, she has a black eye and she said it was,
mm.
she's telling a lie to cover it up, but clearly everyone knows
well,
it's from David.
Seeing, I think he's seeing further down the line.
Exactly.
Which is something I think, like, you know, again, this is, like, the difference in experience that I had watching this when I was 22 versus now. Then it was like, you know, because you do kind of relate, I guess, to the, you know, the idea that there's a parent who's overprotective of the daughter, and, you know, it's like you just want to date the daughter. But now it's like, if from the father's point of view, it's like he is, you know, looking at this situation going like, okay, you know, even the mom, when Reese Witherspoon comes in, she's like, you know, where were you? And she's like, oh, you know, my watch broke. And I'm like, step-mom. The mom knows, or stepmom knows, oh, yeah. Like right there.
She's the true villain in this movie,
the
though.
Evil stepmom.
We have discussed. She is the true villain of this movie.
She might be.
Because she is doing everything she can to turn her husband against his own daughter.
Well, let's put it this way. Everything if nothing she else, can. She's not helping her own cause with the daughter.
Exactly. She's not trying to forge a relationship. She's trying to push them apart.
You guys saw a different movie than
she called her a slut twice in this movie.
But one of them was a joke. One of them wasn't to her. It was to the dad, and it was a joke.
One was to the daughter's face, though.
Yeah, well, the first one was. She explicitly said, like, I'm angry to get away from me, and she said something.
Well, take your makeup off. You look like a slut.
Yeah.
And then the other one, she said to her husband, well, if she keeps wearing her makeup like that, she looks like a slut or something to that effect.
That was the joke.
But like,
it was like, after we've dealt with this fiery situation where I called your daughter a slut and we've worked past it, now I'm like,
but when you have a blended family, you can't set fires like that and then expect everything to be okay. That's not like, as someone who comes from a blended family, that's not how step parents should treat their stepchildren, especially if they want to have a good relationship with everyone in the family. That's not, you can't go around saying shit like that and expect everything to be okay.
But a lot of it does seem like she's trying to, you know, she seems to be building bridges. Building bridges with the daughter, with Reese Witherspoon's character, in a way that she can relate to her, like on some of the feminine things that are happening, the feminine point of view, where the dad can't, because when he comes in, it's like, what, you know, and then the hackles come up and it's like, must go kill.
Right. Well, she does that later, too, when like Mark Wahlberg is over. David is over to the house and everything, like she's trying to extend the hand in that regard as well, because he's
even before
I feel like that was more out of fear. That was my read on that. It was like, it'll just be easier if I just let this happen. It was kind of like
fear of what?
Like it will. Like I think it was just more like it'll be easier if I just let her have him over here than have her act out.
Well, she does say that to him,
you know,
at a certain point,
which is weird because every other interaction with the daughter has been knocking her down as much as she can. But at this point in time, she's going to dial it back.
Yeah.
Her parenting method makes no sense.
I mean, she does have some tender moments where she is acting like a mother towards her.
I think the third act.
No, I think what it is she's in a constant battle of trying to be a mother figure, but then her like anger at her husband and the way he treats Reese Witherspoon's character, I think that takes over most of the time, and she's just like resenting him.
Really?
I think so. I think
that manifests in slut shaming.
Apparently. Yeah, I think she definitely resents his relationship with her because he's constantly giving in to her and not reprimanding her when he needs to. And I think she's mad about that.
I think initially she's mad about the easier relationship. I mean, because anybody's going to be mad if you're the one providing the punishments or setting the rules and the other one gives in too easily, because that's where the resentment comes in.
Right, exactly.
But when you're the step-parent, that's not your call to make. You know what I'm saying?
I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying that's what's happening. When you're the step-parent, that is not your fucking call to make.
Like, yeah.
But it is, how long have we figured out how long they've been together?
We don't know. All we know is that Reese Witherspoon's only been there for about a year.
Right.
Yeah. But they could have both moved.
We don't know how long they've been together.
Right.
Right.
Because before that, it felt like that they had all been a thing for a lot longer.
I don't know, because remember at the beginning, we hear William Peterson's character be like, oh, he called me dad, you know, with Tobias, the kid. So, like, I feel like it's a fairly new situation. Mm-hmm. So to call your fucking new stepdaughter a slut right off the bat is not a great
start.
There's
definitely some tension there in the family that feels like they're working things out.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Like, it doesn't feel like a family that's accustomed to each other.
They're still trying to have family events.
Exactly,
concert and everything.
Yeah.
That's very true.
That's why the whole, like, you know, whatever, the minefield that they have to go through with the Marky Mark incursion, right, is like a team-building experience.
That's going to be my
It is a corporate team-building exercise.
That's my
Sorry, what'd you say?
Yes.
The Marky Mark incursion. That's brilliant. Copyright it.
Copyright 2018 Saturday Night Free Show. The Marky Mark incursion.
That's brilliant. I love it. I love it.
God, I want to see Jesus. That. Fuck Two White Crew. I want the Marky Mark.
That's amazing. Yeah.
You're just going to do a bunch of Good Vibrations covers?
Mostly in just underwear.
Are you going to hit punching bags a bunch like he does in that
in
video?
In underwear, yeah. Yes. This is all the things I'm going to do.
Does he do that in underwear?
Yes,
in the,
yes, he does. Oh, yes, he does.
He does. Yeah. Have you not seen the video for Good Vibrations?
It's been like 20 years? 20-odd years, probably.
Yeah.
Because I was never a fan of fucking Marky Mark and the goddamn
Funky Bunch. But you've never watched like fucking VH1 flashbacks like exactly. I love the 90s or anything. Yeah, come on. I love it.
I have no cable. I'm a cord cutter. I'm out.
Marky Mark,
go back and find find the Wraith soundtrack.
YouTube, you could go watch it on there.
I could, but who would? I mean, so
did we talk about the tattoo?
Oh my God, no, we should talk about the fucking tattoo.
Talk about the tattoo.
So he does what goth kids in your high school did, and mm-hmm. does himself a stick and poke, where he cuts it into his chest and then rubs ink from a pen all over it.
Mm-hmm. And what does it say? What does it say?
Nicole forever.
Forever.
Not
Eva. Not
Eva. For Eva.
Nicole for Eva.
go for Eva. I guess she's running for something.
Yeah, she's running for office. Nicole for Eva. Like, he's a human fucking lawn sign. Stick me in a yard in front of someone's house. Nicole for Eva. You can rent me out.
He's an obsessive type, we know for sure. The impression that this is the first time that he's ever really had this type of, I guess, like, this is when his emotions have become engaged for the first time ever for this girl.
I don't think it's his first time. I mean,
well, the only reason I say that is because, like, he's completely unprepared to deal with it, and he just goes like off the deep end. He's like,
"I think that's teenage hormones. I think that's being a teenager." Honestly,
does it feel like first time girlfriend?
It feels like more than that.
Maybe he just got out of the slammer, and this is the first girl.
There you go. I think
maybe they were out that first night. It was a party to celebrate like his release.
Yeah, because honestly, like, it seems like he knows exactly what he's doing.
Yeah, it feels very calculated.
It really does. Yeah. Well, I don't think this is his first time doing this.
Who knows?
Yeah. I don't think it's his first time.
Yeah, because what if you're a psychopath? Then you really have no emotional response. So his swagger and the like.
But where does the chest tattoo come out of if it's not an emotional response? What is that?
Yeah,
you know. It feels very teenager emotionally to me, is what it feels like.
Or what would you say, like in super inexperienced, like on some kind of on the scale, right?
Imbalance. Yeah, I think it's just an imbalance. Yeah. Like
it's a chemical imbalance. Yeah,
yeah. He's got some serious mental disorders that I wouldn't even begin to diagnose because I don't fucking know. I don't think he's a psychopath or a sociopath, but he's got some fucking
maybe borderline personality.
Maybe.
That whole thing of kind of making his own rules for things. Like, he goes into the women's bathroom to confront her at some point, and it's like, did you even think this through? Or you, I mean, like, he has no concept of boundaries.
He does not think about anything but himself and her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The be all end all.
Mm-hmm. And you wonder how much of that is like movie writing or how much of that is the actual psychology. I'm inclined to think they were thinking in terms of the psychology of the character when they wrote this movie.
Mm-hmm. Well, we talked about several times when we were watching this movie that, like, granted, this was 1996, so it was not a post 9/11 world. But we were talking about how, like, he does not go to the school, but he walks into the school, 10 times in this movie? Mm-hmm. And no one asks questions. No one stops him. He can walk into the lunchroom. He can walk into the bathroom. Yeah. No problems. Whereas, like, post 9/11 world, that's not necessarily as possible.
That's right. Yeah. Kids listening, you used to be able to walk into any high school you wanted and kind of stalk your girlfriend and put notes in her locker.
Also, they
you can't do that
like,
anymore.
Also, they probably had like smoking pits at your high school. But
yeah, probably.
All that shit doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, the courtyard, the commons or whatever. Yeah.
So you don't get any of that cool stuff anymore.
Yeah, we had the parking lot. We still had smoke in our cars. Mm-hmm. So the end of this movie, I guess the reason that William Peterson, I mean, eventually he makes terrible decisions.
He does. He makes a lot of terrible decisions.
Do you lose respect for movie characters when they make a decision that you are just like, well, you're kind of on your own here because, like, I was with you up until this moment and then you went and did something that maybe that's my buy-in.
It depends.
Like, I'm so bought in and when they break that, you know, they're like, what? Well, I wouldn't do that.
You have to think like what is the emotional decision being made here, and you have to sometimes you can maybe like, all right, maybe if I could put myself into that situation, maybe I'd react the same way. But then there's certain things where you're just like, don't
don't do that. Exactly. Don't do the things you're doing right now. Are you that? Because yeah, he does like, some things that are just like,
when he goes
dumb.
To Marky Mark's house and like yeah. breaks up all their shit and destroys everything, you're just destroying evidence at that point. You're mm-hmm. making your case harder
not
to make.
Rational.
Yeah, that
not
was that.
Nice. It's not rational. That, yeah. That's not smart.
That's but an emotional not, response. And, that's not a rational.
And to be honest, yeah. it felt out of character for
I think
did.
It did too.
Yeah.
It, oh, yeah.
It felt
yeah.
very out of character.
Because and this is
that's a Lifetime yeah. movie move.
It is. And
I guess when you're saying that, it's like the function that it serves is so you can have Marky Mark's crew
yeah.
like actually come to the house too, because why else would they do it?
Yeah.
Well, he if, fucked up their shit.
Then you have a motivation.
Yes. I get that,
that
but
is
it's
weak writing.
I get it. I you know why they did it. It still doesn't feel right.
Yeah. It doesn't quite.
Especially for how level-headed his character has been up until this point.
Him
it
calling,
does not make sense.
Him calling his lawyer friend, that felt right in character for mm-hmm. him.
Right. And it like, you know, Holly and I were talking about, you know, as someone who has filed a restraining order, it is very easy to get
it's
one.
It's really easy.
It, you do not yeah. need hardly any evidence, if any, to file a restraining order, at least in the state we live in.
Yeah.
So, you right. know. The fact that like that was not a part of the plot was very unrealistic to me because that would have been the first go-to move. And granted, yeah. people do not have to file restraining orders or do not have to follow them. Mm-hmm. You know, there are a lot of people that violate restraining orders.
Yeah.
So that could have easily
I
been
saw
a plot
unlawful
point.
Unlawful entry.
Yeah, I'm sorry. But like it could have still been the same movie where they file a restraining order and he just breaks it. Mm-hmm. You know, like it yeah. would not have affected
those,
the plot that
and
much.
And those only moments where he actually did call the cops, like you, just judging by his interaction with them, like over the phone, even though we only heard his side of the conversation, completely unrealistic.
Yeah,
their reaction was completely unrealistic,
especially considering they had physical evidence that she'd been assaulted.
She's a 16-year-old
yeah.
girl.
Yeah,
yeah.
But I think the. When the gang comes to his house and they start doing what they do, that is the point where you feel like William Peterson will start going all out and doing the crazy
shit. It's Straw Dogs.
That's where,
yeah.
That's,
yeah
where,
that's what I was thinking.
It's Straw Dogs
like,
at that point.
Straw Dogs
yeah.
moment.
He shouldn't have gone crazy at their place and done all the
exactly.
shit. There should have been another reason to get them there. Then him going nuts and doing whatever he needs to do at that point. Then yeah. I'm just like, I'm in for that.
But
yeah. at this point,
but this is the thing. Like,
yeah.
but Straw Dogs and, you know, like in this movie, they're not working the same way. Although it maybe, I don't know if it would have been better if they did. In Straw Dogs, emasculates its
lead,
male
yeah.
hero.
Yep.
And so, like, in the end, he can, like, find this kind of, like, savage nature
and take
to himself.
His home back. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
But this one doesn't emasculate William Peterson. He does actually, because I was sitting there going, like, you know, is this kid is, like, just kind of, like, every move that you're making is, like, shut the fuck up and sit down. And the kid stands up and goes, like, this is blah, 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 blah. It's like, that's a challenge right there. That's like alpha, you know,
yeah,
kind of behavior.
Yeah.
And William Peterson doesn't back down in that situation. I was like, is he going to beat the shit out of him? He doesn't. But it was still like he's not ceding his territory. I'm like, this guy is not like going to just roll over. Mm. So you can't have that third act, you know, like here's where he finds his, you know, like. Metal, you know?
No, it's not where he finds it's metal. It's where he finds that he's right, or it's when everyone else realizes that he's right.
Yeah,
at that
I suppose
that's
why you
yeah.
put
that's
him
his
in
thing.
Yeah,
that's it's him that character being right because it's supposed to be disbelief of all. It's supposed to be disbelief of his character.
Mm-hmm. He's being the overprotective father.
Right, he's going
you're
too
being
far.
Crazy. You're being
right.
overbearing.
It's,
no, he's
it's him being righteous.
He's
at the
only
end
one
his.
That sees this guy's mm-hmm. ridiculous.
Right, that's his.
Yeah.
Peak at that point.
And yeah. that's why they are able to get the better of him and put him in handcuffs or whatever they tie him up, right?
Yeah.
It's mm-hmm. to
they get him in handcuffs.
Take the power away from him then so he has to be, you know, mm-hmm. tied up on the floor.
Yes.
But
and then it becomes a home invasion movie at that point, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. It becomes a funny games
yeah.
or strangers hostage. Or, yeah.
And I was surprised that the, I mean, it was a moment that I was actually happy for was that the son, the little kid.
Tobias.
He steps Toby. The fuck up.
He had a moment.
That was awesome.
You know?
It
was like,
that was
you
awesome.
Know,
bravo to that kid.
Yeah. He actually had something to do.
He backs up the car over one of Marky Mark's lackeys mm-hmm. and then
yeah.
dials the car phone and calls 911.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
A car
yeah.
phone.
Yeah. yeah.
Like,
yeah,
that's and great. Good job.
Seemingly,
but he's
without...
like, I'll deal with this psychology later. I just need to call the cops right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, because he doesn't even like start crying or break a sweat. He's just like, all right, I'm gonna dial the phone now.
Mm-hmm.
He goes to that survival
just,
part of his yeah. brain where he's yeah. like, I just got to do what I got to yeah. do right now.
Like, I just killed a man, but yep. now I'll dial the phone.
I was wondering how that was going to play out because both Reese Witherspoon and Alyssa Milano are in the bedroom, you know, like, and because all basically anybody under 20 is locked mm-hmm. in a room mm-hmm. for protection, as mm-hmm. you know. The guys are coming in. And so I was like, well, how is this going to play out? But Reese Witherspoon has to tend to her friend, who's distraught because Alyssa Milano, well, granted, she's been abused more so.
Yeah, and she gets date raped by Marky Mark. We should mention that like she
so she's more fragile.
She's losing it.
Yeah,
she is losing it.
With these guys coming in.
Rightfully so.
So it is the kid, like, kind of in that moment, like, you know, he does call to his sister when he sees the shadow of these, you know, people crawling across
the window.
But I was like, so what's going to happen? She's going to have to defend, like, both of them, you know, like, how is this going to play out? And then I was like, you know, trying to, because I don't remember how the movie worked out, but it was like, you know, are we going to say that this guy who works out and he's all muscular, the Marky Mark character, is going to be somehow have to fight Reese Witherspoon? Like, this just doesn't, like, how's that going to play out in a realistic way, I guess? Yeah. And then that's why I was like, holy shit, it is William Peterson does have the moment where he throws the fucking
I was going to say, can I use my $20 word here? He gets defenestrated.
Oh, he does. Defenestrated, yeah.
He does. I get to use that word. Yay.
He does. He gets thrown wonderful.
Out, which means thrown out a window.
Yes, defenestrated.
Defenestrated,
put
yeah.
that one in your dictionaries.
Word of the day, guys.
That's right.
Defenestrated.
Don't word say that you never learned anything on the Saturday Night Freak Show. But Reese Witherspoon does get her moment to stab the fuck out of him.
Yeah. With a peace pipe. Chekhov's peace pipe.
Who knew? We didn't even know it was Chekhov's peace pipe until it was just like, because it came up, we're all like, peace pipe!
Yes! We were laughing so hard that he won her a peace pipe at the carnival where he fucked her on the roller coaster.
Yes.
And then we
finger
were like,
banged.
Finger fucked. Yeah, but like, we were like, ha, fucking peace pipe. And then it, Chekhov's peace pipe, it comes back in the third
I was
act.
Not expecting that to come up. It's like, whoa!
Stabs him in the back with it.
That was the one moment where like, seriously, I like watch all these movies where people are getting stabbed and they keep going. But for some reason, I was buying into the reality that they were like, they're trying to keep this relatively grounded.
Right. He's not a superhuman. He's a big dude, but he's not just like, but he's going to get stabbed.
But he's still
and some
like,
shit.
What, 20 years old?
You have like a sucking chest wound, right? Like that was a punctured lung.
Yeah.
Right? We think?
Yeah.
I don't know.
That was a juicy stab.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll call there's some good blood coming out.
That was a juicy stab. Yeah, he was bleeding.
Yes, it was a juicy stab.
In the back. It's great.
Yeah. But I mean, she gets her, you know.
Right. She gets her moment.
This
her
is
little,
the moment of catharsis and revenge for her character. Like, for all the shit she's had to put up with through this entire movie, she gets him, you know. Yeah. Mortally, I would assume that would eventually kill you. A mortal wound.
Yeah, you're bleeding as much as he was bleeding out
he was
of that.
Bleeding
yeah.
Good, yeah. But then he gets defenestrated. Yeah.
Defenestrated.
Which is wonderful. And the landing is the best part.
That's a good crack sound when his body gets concrete.
That's wonderful.
That's solid.
And that dummy, like,
that dummy was great.
Was pretty gross looking.
Like
it was.
Just full on. It's just
the floppy like neck.
It was just like.
But the way the neck like bounced on the concrete was real gross.
It had pretty good. And then it was like, then the movie's over and the credits roll.
Immediately.
Yeah, and there was like credits.
Like credits are rolling as ambulances are pulling up to the house.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, these
credits
people,
are going.
The filmmakers did not linger on a death or an incident or anything like that.
Well,
like it happened and that was it. Gary got his neck snapped, I think, and he was dead.
There was a linger on a death that made me really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
The dog.
That was fucked up.
That was so fucked up. As I said when we were watching this, guys, if that ever happens to my dog, just fucking kill me. I don't ever want to. I don't want to live after seeing that.
No.
So Kaiser, which is a German Shepherd, gets decapitated, and they take its head and shove it through the dog door, like the dog is coming through the dog door, and then drop the head on the floor.
That starts in front of the whole family. That starts the last 20 minutes. It's just like, whoa. Which was pretty much on like just.
Yeah.
It was just going from that point.
Yeah, I want to live through that.
Kaiser's a German thing, isn't it? Like
a German Kaiser,
It's not weird that the German Shepherd is named Kaiser, right?
Honestly, with how rich this family probably is, considering they built their custom-built house on this like peninsula in Washington,
really
that dog was probably imported from Germany.
Probably.
From
the Kaiser.
Yeah. They built the Purge house? I mean, like,
on the peninsula in Washington,
had that awesome, like, break-resistant glass it had.
Oh, yeah.
Just on the first floor.
Just on the first floor, though.
Did it have shutters also?
No, it just has blinds.
Okay. They were Venetian blinds.
Yes.
Yeah, but the second floor, you can break it with an umbrella.
Well, maybe it just only works from the inside out.
Okay.
How does that glass work? Come on, yeah, where are you, Cornell? Tell me how that shit worked out.
If you're someone who works at Cornell, please tell us how that glass works.
Let us know about your reversible glass-proof glass.
You need to get out.
Right. If you need to shoot your way out while you're inside the car, you're fine.
You want to keep you safe if you're in there, but if you're inside, you got to be able to get out.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, is there any... did we cover fear? Do you feel like we've talked about it?
I think we hit those points, man.
Well, all right. Well, I'll tell you what. Listeners, stick with us because we're going to go around the table. We're going to tell you what we thought of fear. But first, we are... are we doing that with every movie now?
Fear.
I don't think it works with this one.
It doesn't work, but I like it. I like doing
it. What was the one that we did, the fear of the year is here?
What?
No. No, I was about to say you're crazy.
Thank you for the your. So,
I don't know.
Your is available now in the Walmart bargain bin.
It is. Buy T-dubs. I was at Walmart, and I was looking through the bin, and holy shit, there were a lot of your Blu-rays in there.
Yeah. So go buy it.
We did not have to order them from Amazon.
Guys, if we buy enough of them, maybe they'll make another one.
I got to believe that we all ordered it, and they were just like,
fucking toss it in the bin.
Give it to Walmart. Because goddamn it, they weren't there before.
Yeah. Yeah. So maybe it's because of us.
35th anniversary.
If it's just in our city, we'll know.
Right? Yeah, please all go look and let us know.
Please go look and tell us. Because if it's just here where we are, we'll
Dom,
know it's
Dom,
do
they have Walmarts
but...
in us?
Is this the Saturday Night Freak Show Easter egg hunt?
Maybe it is.
The Saturday Night Freak Show mission. We got to have these. The what do you call it? The Saturday Night Freak Show.
I don't know. I feel like
treasure.
You're trying to make a segment right now.
I don't
now.
Really know what you're getting at. So
I'm trying to create a movement out there.
The movement's before the show starts.
I gotta go pee or my bladder's gonna fucking explode.
Okay.
I'll be back.
All right. So what we're gonna do while Michaela's doing that? We are going to read the mail.
Read the mail.
But
yeah.
First of all, we should remind you how you can get a hold of us. You can get a hold of us on Facebook.
Facebook.com/Saturday Night Freak Show.
On Twitter.
@SatFreakShow.
You can write to us via email.
SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com.
And you can also get a hold of us on
Instagram.
Saturday Night Freak Show. You know what we also didn't do? We didn't have Igor bring us the mail. We're all out of sorts. Well, yeah. Igor, bring us the mail.
Masters, the mail. I've got the mail. So many letters. Our followers are rising.
Why, thank you, Igor.
Thanks, Igor. Nice tattoo, Igor.
He looked like he bucked up.
It says Nicole forever.
It says Freak Show forever.
Freak Show forever.
Oh, God, I hope he did that with a better method than Marky Mark.
Does it mark his decaying skin?
Well, he tried to do it with crayon. He doesn't quite get it.
And there's a couple letters there backwards.
Yeah,
you know,
he doesn't really get it. He tried. Yeah, bless his heart.
No, it says Freak Show for Evil. Oh.
All right,
that's fine.
God damn it, Igor.
That's fine. That'll work.
Maybe next time.
Yeah.
All right, so TGS12371 says, great podcast, but the Delta Force was...
A snooze.
Please let Michaela know she is loved by a lonely delivery driver who delivers Amazon packages to a small mountain folks located in Sierra Valley just outside of Reno, Nevada.
Lonely.
Michaela, I want to let you know.
And it was ended with heart face, cry laugh face, thinking face, kissy face, and eye roll face. Those are the emojis he is.
I love you too. Wow. I love anybody that listens to us. So.
And thank you for putting that on my personal Instagram.
I'm going to say I love the idea of someone driving around the desert delivering packages listening to our podcast.
I know.
I love it.
I love it.
That's great. That's the best thing in the world.
Thank you.
Yeah,
very
thank
much.
You. Whether you write it to us or just Holly about
appreciate it. Feel free to tell everyone else on the show that you love them through my Instagram. Yeah.
That's fine.
I'll also take more fan mail through Holly's Instagram.
Sure.
I think,
you know what? Find us at Holly Joy on Instagram. That's our new thing.
Miss_Holly_Joy.
There you go. Write to us there.
Tell Holly how much you love me.
Feel free to tell me how much you love my co-host. It's great. That's great. I love it.
Could you pass a message on your co-host?
Even though he followed me on Instagram, so I was like, just you can just tell me. It's okay.
Maybe
it's fine.
Maybe
I don't bite.
He just doesn't. Maybe he thinks you do.
I mean, if he's trying to make, if he's trying to make me jealous, it kind of worked.
We'll see. So.
This is you've created. Thanks a lot. TGS12371.
Also you've, simplify that name.
You've created drama here on
There's
the pre-show.
There's animosity
so,
now.
Congratulations. it was all friendly, and now
we're going to be Alyssa Milano and Reese Witherspoon. Now it's not going to work out for us.
There's going to be some
I'm not quite sure who's who in that scenario
this year.
Hopefully, neither of us. God, that's a bad outcome for both of us.
All right. So Bruce Terry also writes in.
Hi, Bruce.
What up?
He says, I love this pod. Fucking Travis is crazy, man. Would love to hear you guys talk about some game
tones.
Well,
he gone. So.
Well,
yeah, I was gonna say, well, when you must have started early.
Well, I hope you don't hate me because...
I mean, I hope you don't.
Because you'll figure it out when you get to it.
Maybe he hasn't gotten up to these episodes yet. Yeah. If you're listening to this episode, then thank you very much.
You're a surprise if you get
to it. It's a roller coaster.
Like this movie, this episode, it's just a fucking.
It's a wild horse, man.
It's a wild horse.
It's a wild horse, man.
Bringing it back around to fear. Well, so is Tony Genoway.
Oh.
Tony says this was destined about fear that this was destined to be a lifetime channel schlock until they realized, holy fuck, Marky Mark and Reese Witherspoon are signed on, and Melissa Milano's mommy hadn't yet tried to ban the interwebs from showing her daughter's best acting assets in movies already released.
Yeah, no, it literally is a lifetime movie with a bigger budget. Yeah. That's exactly what it is. That is the best description
just,
of it.
Young people acting who eventually became stars.
$6.5 million budget, by the way.
That seems about right.
Yeah, it seems like you feel that all on the screen. It hit $20 million at the box office, so this was a huge hit.
Oh, wow.
Mike Welch, he says that Marky Mark could get a job at Euro Tattoo. That's a local call out. Thank you very much.
I gotta say, as a local, I love that joke, and I find that to be fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
Knowing the reputation of Euro Tattoo around here, I find that to be accurate.
Yeah, that's fucking funny. Spot on.
I laughed so hard when I read that. That made my fucking
funny.
Day.
We like local.
That is funny.
Well, he also wants us to know that Bing's Drive-In is still open.
I told you. I told you.
Okay, so what it was they had closed part of the road that Bing's is on. That's what I heard, I misinterpreted that. So yeah, that Bing's was. They were
it's
worried.
It's on the west side.
They were worried South that Main, they were right? going South Main, to that they were that it was going to impact their business.
Yeah, South Main.
A lot of construction. Wayne Lustig says, "I've seen Fear several times. He's a real badass."
Who?
William Pete. Peterson?
Yeah, Marky Mark? Do you mean Marky Mark? Because I don't really like
do you
that.
You accidentally mean Reese Witherspoon? Oh, we don't know.
If you just Tobias? Said. Do you mean Tobias? Because I agree. Right. I agree.
You're right,
yes.
Sir.
Do you mean Kaiser the dog?
Kaiser.
Yeah. Aww. Yeah. Agreed.
May he
rest in peace, Kaiser. Yeah. Oh, sad.
Nick Seibel. Nick Seibel. Says great soundtrack. Bush.
Yeah.
Does have a great soundtrack.
16 Stone.
This is back in the day when a roller coaster was a game. Changer, laugh out loud.
Yeah, no, the like roller coasters mean something different to people who that have seen this movie,
yeah,
than to people who have not.
Steve Coate, 1974, says it was a good thriller movie back then, but the question is, did it hold up?
That is the question we'll answer.
You'll find out.
All right, about M movie Anaconda, last week's episode, Brent Zemecki says, long time listener, first time caller. I've always wanted to say that.
I
love your podcast and cannot wait to hear your Anaconda review. Keep up the good work, guys.
It's a good show.
It's a good episode. You'll enjoy it.
I had fun on that episode.
That was fun.
I feel good about that episode.
Yeah, that was a fun one, dude.
We did. That was.
There's some tangents, but they are good tangents.
Yeah.
All the good things on that episode.
I suppose we should say, if it's not obvious by now, we record like a week in advance.
Yep. Yeah. So upon hearing this, Anaconda is available.
Yeah.
Please listen to that episode.
Yep. Yeah. Go back and listen to it.
Yeah.
Sexy netting. We'll meet some
sexy netting.
Sexy netting.
Yes, sexy
that's
netting.
What I'm saying. By tangents, the sexy netting tangent was a good
sexy
one.
Netting.
And we'll be reviewing.
Can't wait to listen to that tomorrow.
That was great.
We'll be talking about your comments to that episode on next week's episode.
Yep.
It's all crazy.
Oh, Jesus
Christ. Love it. Time is a flat circle, you know?
That's right. About the Wraith, Gary Norris writes in.
Gary. Hi, Gary.
The Wraith.
Gary, used to be on the Freak Show. He says the soundtrack took me years to find it after it was pulled for using songs without proper permission.
Oh, that explains a lot, actually.
Interesting.
I did look it up. It is out of print. I don't know if it was pulled, but it was definitely out of print.
So they just threw whatever they wanted on that soundtrack and then just made the movie and said, fuck it, whatever happens, happens.
I love that.
I can appreciate that.
That's really funny.
Ozzy's on the soundtrack, but Motley Crue, Billy Idol, Robert Palmer.
Did not agree.
Bonnie Tyler? She is. That's the last song on the song.
Interesting. Very interesting. So they did not get clearance for that stuff, huh?
Just like, I don't know. That's maybe it was you get the rights to do it in the movie, but not put it on an album. Mark Packard writes in, says, I love The Wraith. And Sluts and Guts writes,
I like that name. I dig it.
Oh, I hope you're a woman.
Writes in and says, I still enjoy The Wraith as if it was my first time watching it.
As the only person who recommended that, I agree.
Don't remember. Were you the only one who recommended
it? Yes, I was.
Are you going to change it now?
Recommendation.
No,
for the
I know, because I have no memory of anything. I don't know if you know.
Even the movie?
If nobody else, I drink heavily. I remember the movie completely.
Oh, okay.
Where the podcast ends up. I remember everything up to the reviews, and then I'm just like, what happened? And what are we watching next week?
That's why you have to listen to the episode.
That's why I'm so looking forward. I mean, listening to it, I was just like, oh, I'm surprised myself listening to these episodes sometimes. It's like, oh, I didn't recommend
after,
it. Wow,
after a couple weeks, I usually forget everything.
We don't usually remember what movie we're covering the week we're doing it. Yeah. So,
that's true.
You
know, that's true.
And I got to put that together tomorrow. And sometimes I'm sitting there going, like, crap. Shit. Like, what? Yeah. It's been a while since I've actually had to go.
You can't always just message us like an ass.
What did we say it was?
Yeah.
All right. So
we're
now
drinking during this podcast. Did we mention that?
Yeah.
That's right. But we're not eating anymore. So that's a good thing.
It's not a problem. I brought chocolate chip cookies.
No, I know,
but we will eat off mic.
Close to getting into it right now during my review.
So now is the moment that you've all been waiting for. You're going to find out what we thought of The Wraith, because clearly our
The Wraith?
God damn it.
Fear. Fear.
It's the alcohol. See?
Fear.
The alcohol.
The Wraith was 2 weeks ago, Colin. Wrong introductions brought to you by Shiner Buck. Yep.
That's right. It's only three of them.
That's
right?
Also how they're going to end.
You didn't throw one of these away. Three beers. I'm a lightweight. Wait, I need another one.
Get him another one. And Colin.
I'm on it.
What did you think about Fear? I almost said The Wraith.
You did. I saw it.
I was just like, what do we watch? Fear.
I would love to tell you about this film, which shall remain nameless.
I don't know what the name is.
Yes.
What if we all just gave like the most generic wrap ups?
It was great.
I had so much fun tonight.
I loved every moment. Dragons are great. Butter's good too. This movie was awesome. And it's like, what?
Definitely recommend.
I mean, the experience, like, I gotta tell you, Michaela, when you said you were bringing Fear, I'm like, oh, Fear. Oh, awesome. Yeah, that was kind of, you know, because it feels, I guess, my take on it was it's a little more respectable than the fare that we usually bring here on the Freak Show. I'm like, it's a real legitimate movie. And so watching it again tonight,
we're pretty shocked.
It's
when
like,
that happens.
Yeah, I know.
Here.
It's a real legitimate movie.
Because it's not a Lifetime movie. It's like a notch above a Lifetime.
No,
it's like one notch. Like,
I would say it's even better than that.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, I think the writing's solid.
Exactly. I mean, I think character motivations check. You know, it's like these are decently well-rounded characters, all of them. And I think the appeal of it, like I was saying earlier, I get how, you know, from a female perspective, it is kind of the, you know, you are following the Reese Witherspoon character arc. She's the one who makes this change. And I think it is like, you know, from girlhood to adulthood. But there's also the William Peterson character, which I was surprised, I guess, this time watching it, because it's like it actually did give me like a way into the movie. And I was like, holy cow, you know, it's like I'm completely identifying with this guy now, even though I don't have kids. But I'm like, this is why you don't have kids.
That's called getting old.
You're just old. Yeah. I was going to say, you're just old now.
No, you know you're old when you go from identifying with the teenager in a movie to identifying with the parents.
Yeah. All those kids are fucking annoying.
But I appreciated that the movie allowed me to watch it from two, you know, over a span of years from two different perspectives. and it was a different viewing experience, and I liked it more.
Movies don't change, Colin. You
change. Yeah.
Exactly.
I liked it more this time than I did the first time I watched it, to be honest with you, because the first time I was like, it's a thriller, blah, you know, and it just didn't connect with me in the same way, and this time it actually did. So I thought, you know, it's well acted. It's got a bunch of people in it that I like. I thought the direction was good. I mean, technically, I thought it was well done. I mean, it's a legitimate movie. I would recommend Fear, even if, you know, I mean, I assume that you've seen it if you're listening to this podcast.
Maybe
if
not,
you,
Colin.
If you haven't, you know, I would say, yeah, you should check it out. Of that era's thrillers, this is a pretty good one. So yeah, check out Fear. Holly, what'd you think?
Yeah, no, I'm right with you. I grew up with this movie, so sometimes it's hard to differentiate whether I have nostalgia for something or if it's actually like legit. I think Fear definitely holds up. I think the thriller aspect is spot on. It's definitely a scary movie at times. You know, you put yourself in that scenario, the home invasion, and as a woman, like it is scary because these are actual fears that we deal with constantly, especially like I'm a single woman. Anytime I date somebody, I have fears that directly relate to this sort of scenario. So it is a scary movie in that aspect. But I agree with Colin. I think it's above a Lifetime movie. I think the writing is solid. The characters are really wonderfully written. Obviously it's got its flaws, but I think it's still holds up for sure. I think it's a good movie. I definitely feel like it's more than just a nostalgic thing. Yeah, I had fun watching it, and for sure, yeah, Fear, recommend. Sean.
This movie was produced by Brian Grazer. I don't think we mentioned that before. And Rick Kidney.
That sounds like a fake name.
I just like the name, so I wanted to bring it up.
So it's Ron Howard, right? That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's Ron Howard's name.
His name is Rick Kidney. Yeah.
It has to be, right?
Yeah.
It has to be. Brian Grazer, it has to be.
Because Brian Grazer produces most, if not all, of Ron Howard's movies.
Yeah, so. Everything.
Well, together,
yeah.
They're Imagine Entertainment.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. So Rick Kidney is Ron Howard.
When he doesn't want to be Ron Howard.
Right.
Yeah.
He's just like, yeah. I don't want to exactly put my name on it, but you can put Rick Kidney.
Like when Anne Rice wrote the fucking like Sleeping Beauty series.
Oh.
Yeah. What was her name?
What was that name?
It was Anne. Was it still Anne?
It still Anne?
Or when J.K. Rowling wrote that adult mystery series Robert Galbraith.
Yeah, that's very true. Fear. Like we said before, I'd never heard of this movie at this point. Even watching it tonight, I'm just like, you know what? Some scenes felt familiar, but I don't think I've ever like sat down and watched this.
Probably because there are references like pop culture scenarios. Yeah.
Like we said, it's always Sunny references this movie all the time.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm sure you'd heard of things at some point.
Something about the movie felt familiar, if nothing else, than the screenplay or the situations that people get in. Like we said, we identified the William Peterson character as the character who knows things are not going right, that things are off. And that nobody believes him, but then later on, like, everyone will eventually realize that what he's saying is correct and that, you know, the whole scenario is weird. But I was pleasantly surprised by Fear tonight. I think it is, it's pretty well written. The cast is doing good. I had a good time. Like I said, the last 20 minutes, I was just like, whoa.
Yeah.
All right. I'm down for this. And
the drill in the hand. Yeah.
The drill in the hand. The dog. I think it's the dog head through the dog door that really got me. That was just like, whoa.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. We're getting into some shit here. I mean, I recommend this movie. I had a good time. I think everyone plays their character very well. I'm kind of scared of Mark Wahlberg right now. I mean, I usually am because he's just a bigger gentleman than I am.
Sure.
But as an intense dude who just has very intense feelings about Reese Witherspoon.
Yes.
So, and he scares me. So, everyone feels believable in their roles in this movie.
Absolutely.
And I think that's the key to this movie being a good movie, is that everyone's in the role, everyone's doing good, everyone's believable. I believe they're in danger, so... I think everybody did a pretty good job in this movie. I recommend Fear for the first time seeing it. I'm surprised, but watch Fear. It's a good movie.
Yeah, I'm shocked. I am floored right now at three recommends right now.
I'm surprised.
I am shocked. But
Michaela's like, I hate this movie.
I brought it here because I hate it.
So on paper, if you were to read the script, you'd be like, this is a fucking Lifetime movie. Mm-hmm. You're like, this does not deserve $6.5 million. It doesn't deserve Marky Mark. It doesn't deserve Reese Witherspoon. You know, it doesn't deserve William Peterson. No, it doesn't.
I saw this movie in the 90s. It was called Mother May I Sleep With Danger, starring Tori Spelling.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Very true.
However, this movie's on another level. Like, I mean, I've seen Marky Mark in a lot of stuff, and I think this and The Departed are like the two best things he's probably ever done. You know?
Rockstar's pretty good.
Boogie Nights?
Rockstar.
All right.
You maybe take that's back. When was the last time you watched Rockstar?
It's probably been in like a year.
I watched it like three weeks ago. That movie is trash, man.
It's like, whoa. All right, you know what? Like, Trump card. I watched it more recent than you. Bam.
You know what?
Because another podcast covered it, and I watched it for that podcast.
It may
and
be
said,
a trash movie, but I like it. And that's
not what I'm asking. I'm asking Marky Mark's best movies.
It's a trash movie.
Yeah.
I like it, though. But, all right, as far as best movies for Marky Mark.
Yeah,
that's fair.
Departed and this. That's it, right?
I'm sure.
Like, what else is there? Daddy's Home 2?
Boogie Nights? Have you ever seen
Boogie Nights? Boogie Nights is like, I would put third, I guess.
Did you ever see Four Brothers?
Yeah, he was great in that movie.
That's, I think it's a really good movie.
And Andre 3000 is good in that movie, too.
I think they're all really good in that movie.
Honestly, that movie did not get enough credit.
I don't think it does.
I think that movie is a decent movie.
That's a good movie.
But, I mean, what between here and there, it's what, Italian Job and...
I'm sure we're like this. Fight, didn't he do
Daddy's
Fighter?
Home?
Fighter.
Like, he's done some good shit.
He's done some bad stuff too.
He's done some bad stuff.
Yeah, he's kind of I'll take whatever you throw at me kind of guy, and that's his problem. He needs to be more discriminating with the projects he takes.
I'm a problem.
But
Ted.
The part Ted, yeah, exactly. Daddy's Home too.
There's a big lot of hit.
I'm just gonna throw on that. That was a terrible fucking bit.
I think, though, that, like, the part where he is, like, really unleashing his rage.
Invincible.
Invincible.
Oh, yeah.
That's another It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia connection.
It is.
Sure. Yeah.
Because they do a whole episode about they try out for the Philadelphia Eagles just like the movie. And they literally say, we're going to be Marky Mark and Invincible. They literally say that in this movie. So, but
Invincible is a parent movie. My parents love that
Yeah,
movie.
That's a dad movie.
Yeah.
But in this movie, the part where he's, like, screaming through the people is, like, the one time when you really see his rage kind of like untethered and unleashed and like it's fucking scary, man.
Scary.
And like
I love that because as soon as he screams and he backs up with that smile, like it's so creepy. Scary. It's so creepy.
And like he doesn't even give a fuck if you're watching him or not. He's just presenting, you know? Like, yeah. It's
very true.
It's so uncomfortable.
Yeah, like no, there like I said, there are points of this movie that are borderline triggering for me.
Yeah.
Having lived through similar circumstances.
There's a lot of stuff that gets a little too real.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
It's just like, ooh.
Yeah.
Whereas Lifetime movies feel like another planet.
They're always
Lifetime movies feel like another
fucking
universe.
Very separate.
Coming from them at all. I feel a threat coming from
You watch The Craigslist Killer and tell me if
and
you can
laugh.
Relate to that
you
shit.
You fucking laugh at that shit. Yeah, exactly.
Oh god.
Reese Witherspoon is really great. William Peterson is obviously awesome. We talked about how we have a theory that the stepmom is a secret villain of this movie. We'll elaborate on that. Ask us about it. You know, if you want to hear
through my Instagram, apparently.
Yeah. But I think this movie, I feel like it kind of got buried, but at the same time, there are certain like circles of pop culture that they reference it all the time. Mm-hmm. Definitely check out Fear. I think it's worth watching. I think it is surprisingly higher quality than you would expect for a movie of its type.
Yeah. It is.
So I would definitely recommend it.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, there it's Fear. That's four.
Four
that's,
recommends for Fear.
Saturday Night Freak Show
four for
approved.
Fear.
Yeah. So
no tears for Fear. Four for Fear.
Although I recommend them too.
Yeah.
To a certain extent, I think we all do.
Oh, Kurt Smith.
So next week we're gonna watch a movie that's chosen by
Colin. What are we gonna watch next week?
Well, since Michaela tried to make the joint all respectable, I'm gonna bring us back down to the gutter.
Yeah.
I'm gonna show you the flip side of The Shape of Water with a movie called Humanoids from the Deep.
Yeah, let's do it. I'm down.
Wow. Michaela's really
I'm down.
That was a
yeah. It's a Corman movie,
it
right?
It is, yeah. I've been on a Corman kick.
Yeah.
Humanoids
from the Deep.
Humanoids from the Deep. So that's next week on the Saturday Night Freak Show. We hope you'll stick around and join us. And